this only believes simple believism, free grace theology. It will do nothing but lead you to hell. It is a dead faith. Now, you can sit there and play semantics and say, well, works are the fruit of the Spirit. Okay, amen. But you still have to do them. And the Holy Spirit doesn't compel you to do those works. Those works are done of your own choosing. We can choose not to do them. And if we choose not to do them, our faith is dead. Hey everyone, welcome to Catholicism. Wow. So today we are going to take a look at a video from Onorato Diamonte. Onorato Diamonte is a person that we've looked at before on this channel. He's a free gracer. He's a proponent of simple believism, which means that all you have to do is believe, and that's all that it requires to be saved. And that's just not true. That's contrary to what is in the scriptures. And we're going to see that in this video. But in this video, Onorato decided to go up against Sam Shamoun. And he actually has a few different videos trying to rebut Sam Shamoun. And we'll see, he doesn't do a very good job. So the way Onorato's video is played out is he plays Sam's whole clip and then he responds to it. So what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and let Sam's clip play through, and then we'll get into Onorato's responses to those, and then I will, of course, respond to him. So let's get into it.
John 3:36. From the words of the Lord Jesus himself.
Here you go.
He who believes, well, when I say the Lord Jesus, I keep forgetting this particular section. It's John the Apostle who is writing these statements by inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So it's not Jesus himself on earth. It's Jesus from heaven speaking through John by the Holy Spirit. So let me just be careful. He who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God abides in him. Did you catch it? Believing in the Son is obedience to the Son. If you don't obey the Son, you're not believing in the Son. Did you catch it? And yet they give you a note, footnote saying the word obey can mean believe. Are you catching it? John, by inspiration of the Spirit of Christ, says, believing in the Son is obedience to the Son. Believing in the Son is obeying the Son. If you don't obey the Son, if you're not obedient to the Son, you're not believing in the Son. Now let's see what that word is for obedience. Let's see. Okay. What's the word for obey? Scroll down. You see the word? Apeithon. Apeis negation, peithon. Click on it. Apeithon. 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 What does it mean? Now go to your Strong's Greek 544, sir. Apeithio. Apatheo, what's the definition? To disobey. Rebel, disloyal, refuse conformity. Did you catch it? It is obedience or lack thereof. Scroll down so we can go look at the lexical. If you stay there, we're not going to see it. Apatheo, literally refuse to be persuaded by the Lord. Apatheia. Let's look at the definition. Scroll down. Apatheis. Apatheis. Disbelieve, disobedient. Do not obey, obey. Are you seeing it? Okay, apatheo, the imperfect, hepathon, aorist, hepathisa. Not to allow oneself to be persuaded, not to comply with. Scroll down. To refuse or withhold belief, to be disobedient. Keep going. to refuse belief and obedience. Because if you don't believe, you're not going to obey. But if you believe, you're going to obey. To refuse belief and obedience. You caught it? Now scroll down a little bit slowly. Okay, go on, let's see. Apathetic, right? Strong's, to disbelieve, disobey. From apathes. To disbelieve willfully, perversely. Not believe, disobedient. Obey not, unbelieving. So Greek, epithes. Okay, see it? Okay. Are you catching it? So are you seeing the Spirit of Jesus inspired John to equate believing with obedience? Believing in Jesus is obeying Jesus. If you're not obeying Jesus, you're not believing in Jesus. So the belief, the faith that God requires of you to obtain immortality, to be justified, is obedience to Christ. Is obedience to Christ. You caught it?
So what Sam is doing here is something that I think a lot of times we forget or don't think of doing in our regular Bible studies, but this is extremely important. We have to understand that the Bible was not written in English. It was not written in modern English. It was not written in Elizabethan English. It was not written in any kind of English at all. Your English Bible is not the inerrant, inspired word of God. Your English Bible is a translation of the inerrant, inspired work of God. And because of that, you have to make sure that you're reading a translation that faithfully gives you what the Bible was trying to communicate or what the biblical authors were trying to communicate in the original languages, Hebrew for the Old Testament and Greek for the New Testament. And so Sam is looking up this word that translates to who does not obey to verify what it meant in the Greek. And what it meant in the Greek is to not obey. Now, there are other translations like the King James Version, which Onorato is absolutely a KJV onlyist, that translate that word as does not believe. So he who believes in the Son has eternal life. He who does not believe does not have eternal life. That's just not a correct understanding of that passage, because that word literally means to not obey. And we will see later on, we will look at some other passages in the Greek. This is something that the free gracers will not go to the original languages. And this is why a lot of them are KJV onlyists, because the King James Version of the Bible was translated just after the Protestant Reformation with a definite Protestant bias in mind. In fact, an Anglican bias, because it was commissioned by King James, who was the successor of King Henry VIII. King Henry VIII founded Anglicanism, founded the Church of England, because he didn't like that the Catholic Church would not grant him an annulment or a divorce. So already we have an axe to grind in translating the King James Version. And that axe absolutely comes through with all the errors that are abundant in the King James Version. Now, can you read the King James Version and still understand and still get a fullness of the biblical intent out of it? Sure, you can. It's not so twisted that it's not like the New World Bible, where it's mistranslated on purpose to say something completely different. But it is mistranslated subtly to where the translators could say, no, this is what this means, but lead the readers to believe, like Onorato believes, that all you have to do is believe, have faith, and that's it, you're good. Now, as we'll see going on, there are other Bible verses that absolutely refute this idea. So it doesn't have to just be that the Greek doesn't go along with this. Because, yeah, you can absolutely translate those words as not believe. But what does it mean to not believe? Well, like Sam pointed out, it means to not obey. But let's get into Onorato's response.
John chapter 3, verse 36 in the ESV reads, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him." The New American Standard Bible says, "The one who believes in the Son has eternal life, but the one who does not obey the Son will not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him." The rendering of this passage in the modern versions is a source of confusion for many, especially when cited by those attempting to redefine what it means to believe in Jesus.
And of course, those who are trying to redefine what it means to believe in Jesus are the evangelicals and the free gracers like Onorato here. It's clear from the Greek what the intention was when John wrote those words. When John wrote the words of Jesus down in Greek, he wrote them in that way that defines it as he who believes and he who does not obey. So the modern translations that Onorato was saying are confusing are correct. You're only confused because you're the one trying to redefine what it means to believe in Jesus, which is to have allegiance. That's what it means to have faith. And by that definition of the word faith, which is how the Bible uses that word, Catholics would affirm faith alone. But so many Protestants want to take it to the point past that, where you don't have to do anything at all, especially the free gracers. So let's go on.
However, the Word of God is abundantly clear concerning the way in which an individual obeys Christ specific to salvation. John chapter 6, starting off in verse 28, "Then said they unto him, What shall we do that we might work the works, plural, of God? Jesus answered and said unto them, This is the work, singular, of God," don't miss that ye what? "Believe on him whom he hath sent." Look at verse 40 of the very same chapter. "And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life," or life that will last forever, "and I might raise him up at the last day." Is that what he said? No. "I will raise him up at the last day." According to Christ, the singular work and will of God is to believe on him.
All right. So the root word in both of those verses that he cited is pistuo. Now, when we look up the definition of the word pistuo, which is translated as believe or having believed or to believe, when we look up what does that word actually mean, we get to believe, put one's faith in, trust, with an implication that actions based on that trust may follow. So the Greek word used has the implication that there is some kind of action that comes from this belief. It's like if I ask you, "Do you believe that if you fell, I would catch you?" And you say, yeah, I believe that. Okay, great. Now fall. You have to fall. You have to demonstrate that you actually have that faith that I will catch you. Because if you don't do the works, if you don't do the actions based on the trust that you have, then it's just words. Your trust, your belief, your faith is just words. And what do we see from James? So what that you believe there's one God? Even the demons believe and tremble. It is not just, it has never been the intention of Jesus or the biblical authors that wrote down his words that all you have to do is just have an intellectual belief. You have to have an active belief, an active faith that works itself out through good works. And we see that again all over the Bible.
The sole condition for salvation from the penalty of sin is faith in Christ alone. Romans chapter 10, verse 16 says, "But they have not all obeyed the gospel." Notice that phrasing. "For Esaias saith, Lord, who hath believed our report?"
So I'm not sure what Onorato's intention was for quoting this particular verse in Romans, unless it was just to show that there was a difference between believing and obeying. But this doesn't work for him, because the word, again, this is another King James Version bad translation. Because the word translated in the King James as obey is hypekuson. And what that actually translates to is more like heeded. So not everyone heeded the gospel. Not everyone understood or took notice of the gospel. Not everyone listened. Because, and it goes back to a prophecy in Isaiah, Isaiah 53 verse 1, which again was also, John also makes reference to this prophecy in his gospel, that not everyone is going to believe, not everyone is going to listen, not everyone is going to heed the gospel. But that doesn't it doesn't prove the point that Onorato is trying to prove. So I really don't understand what the deal was with that, citing that verse, other than Onorato just doesn't know how to read the Bible, and he keeps proving it over and over and over again, which is often the case with these free gracers. That's why they're free gracers.
2 Thessalonians chapter 1, starting off in verse 8. "In flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day." The gospel is obeyed when the gospel is believed. I'll say that again. The gospel is obeyed when the gospel is believed.
No, you have that backwards. It's not that the gospel is obeyed when the gospel is believed. Believing the gospel denotes obeying the gospel. See, it's the other way around, and that's important. That is important. Because again, like James tells us, even the demons believe and tremble. Do the demons have a true saving faith? No, of course not. They're in hell. They rebelled. They were disobedient, even though intellectually they knew. They knew there is one God, and they were disobedient to him. So as it just comes back to believe equates to obedience. Obedience doesn't equate to simple believing.
Meaning, we obey the gospel, how? Not by keeping a plurality of commandments or by meeting a plurality of conditions, but by believing the gospel, by trusting in Christ and what he did for us. This is the consistent witness of literally scores of passages throughout the Word of God.
Now, Onorato is going to go on a shotgun binge, just throwing out a bunch of verses that don't say what he wants them to say because he's taking them all out of context. But again, the root word for believe in all of these verses, it's the same word, pistuo, which I already showed that belief in the Bible isn't just an intellectual understanding or an intellectual belief. There is action that is implied in the word believing. But let's just go ahead and let him get through his verses, and then I'll throw out some verses of my own.
John chapter 3, verse 16, for example, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, what, believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to who? Everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26, for ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, starting off in verse 8, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Philippians chapter 3, verse 9 says, and be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. Notice this, the righteousness which is of God, how? By faith. 1 John chapter 5, verse 5 says, who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?
All right. So a couple of the verses that Onorato threw out in his shotgun there, a couple of them didn't use the word belief. They were used the word faith. Now, faith, as used in those verses in Greek, is the word pistios. Pistios is defined as faith, faithfulness, belief, trust, with an implication that actions based on that trust may follow. The faith often refers to the Christian system of belief and lifestyle. So again, you see, the Greek word for faith is also very similar to the Greek word for belief. There is an implication that actions will follow. And again, this is absolutely what we see in the Bible. Mark 16, 16. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. So we see salvation requires two things, belief and baptism. Without belief, without faith, all the baptism in the world doesn't mean anything. But without baptism, what does your faith mean? We see this again in Matthew chapter 25. All of Matthew chapter 25, as a matter of fact. Verses 1 through 13, Jesus tells the story of the 10 virgins. The 10 virgins who, five of them, are there waiting for a prince to come to escort them into a party. Five of the virgins have enough oil to keep their lamps lighted. Five do not. And the lamps must be lighted when the prince arrives. So the five unprepared virgins try to borrow some oil from the prepared virgins. And the prepared virgins said no, because if we give you some of our oil, we might not have enough. Then all of us are screwed. So go buy some and come back. Well, when they went to buy some, the prince came, took the five virgins that were prepared into the party. The five who were unprepared didn't get in. You have to do stuff. And then verses 14 through 30, the parable of the talents. The first two servants that were given 10 talents and 5 talents each, they put their talents to work. They put their money to work. They invested their money. They took the grace they were given and put it to work. The one servant that got one talent, He buried his talent in the sand. He did nothing with it. He hid it in the underwear drawer. And when the master came back, the first two gave him back what he originally gave them and more. The last one gave only back what he had been given. He didn't make any more money. He didn't put that money to work. He didn't invest it. And what happens? That servant gets cast into where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. That servant goes to hell. And then in verses 31 through 46 to end the chapter, Jesus talks about two groups of people. One group of people feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick and in prison. The other group of people do not do those things. And Jesus said, when you didn't do these to the least of your brothers, you didn't do them to me. And those people go to hell. They're called wicked. And they go to hell. Simply believing isn't enough. Your works are necessary. Your works must accompany your faith, or they mean nothing. Your faith is meaningless unless you have true allegiance and obedience. And obedience doesn't just mean believing. Believing connotates having an obedience. If you're not obedient, you don't truly believe. And of course, he quoted Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, and as Protestants always do, he left off verse 10, Ephesians 2, 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Yes, salvation is a free gift by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. You don't earn your salvation. But once you are given the grace, once you are saved, once you have that belief in Christ, you're required to do the works that God created in advance for us to do. And then, of course, the death knell for free grace, faith alone, all this Protestant nonsense is in James chapter 2, starting at verse 14. What does it profit, my brethren, if a man says he has faith, but has not works? Can his faith save him? And of course, the connotation of that question is no, it cannot. Your faith without works cannot save you. Continuing with verse 15, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and in lack of daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, what does it profit? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. Verse 17. But some will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I by my works will show you my faith. Your faith is meaningless without works. Your faith is lived out through your works. Continuing with verse 19. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. We went through this earlier. Do you want to be shown, you foolish fellow, that faith apart from works is barren, useless? Faith without works is useless. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered his son Isaac upon the altar? You see that faith was active along with his works. And faith was completed by works. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And he was called the friend of God. You see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone. That's the only time that the words faith and alone are ever used in the Bible, when it says you're justified by works and not by faith alone. Finishing out the chapter with verses 25 and 26. And in the same way, was not also Rahab the harlot justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out another way? For as the body apart from the spirit is dead, so faith apart from works is dead. This only believes simple believism, free grace theology, it will do nothing but lead you to hell. It is a dead faith. Now, you can sit there and play semantics and say, well, works are the fruit of the Spirit. Okay, amen. But you still have to do them. And the Holy Spirit doesn't compel you to do those works. Those works are done of your own choosing. We can choose not to do them. And if we choose not to do them, our faith is dead. And that is what the Bible teaches. That is what the Bible testifies to. The Bible testifies to the importance of faith, and that that faith must be lived out by your works. So everybody, that's all I have for you today. If you like this video, share it with your friends, share it in your social media groups. If you're not already subscribed to my channel, please hit the subscribe button. Make sweet, sweet love to the notification bell. Thank you everybody for joining me. Go in peace and have a nice day.